Okay, we're going to do something together that, to my knowledge, has never been done before, never been presented before. So, what we're going to do is we're going to choose certain cards from the deck here, and then I'm going to allow you to kind of randomize that little packet, whatever quantity we happen to choose, and then we'll take a look at those cards and see if there's kind of anything interesting about the cards that we kind of randomly chose and then randomly mixed. Okay, so what I need you to do to begin this is just cut off some portion of cards, maybe less than half, so that we have something to work with still. So maybe you'll cut off a portion like this. So very good. You'll have to just kind of trust that that was truly a random cut. And now my job is to deal out cards until I get a strong impression that I should stop dealing. Okay, so I may have to concentrate to get a clear signal as to, okay, stop dealing now, kind of thing. So I'll start to deal here. Yeah, I think I'm done. I feel like I should stop right there. So there we go. So we had you randomly cut off a certain number of cards from the top. And then from there, I actually dealt out some number of cards from the top that remained. And then we have these discard cards over here. Now, for the first time, let's find out how many cards you randomly cut. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Very good. So you randomly cut 9 cards. Well, what we're going to do is we're going to remove that quantity of cards from this packet and just throw them away. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Okay. So let's just toss these to the side. We don't need them anymore. So this will be kind of our little random portion of the deck that together we have chosen. And now, what I'd like you to do is help me randomize the order now. Okay, now, the order of the cards is a bit weird because of all this dealing. That's true. But I want you to feel like you had a significant role in kind of deciding what the order of these cards is. Now, if you were here, I would have you tell me when to stop dealing as I deal out piles. But you're not here, so I'm going to have to resort to kind of a random event here, a die roll to tell me like how many to deal into each pile. So let me just roll this. Oh, I got a 6. Okay, very good. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Roll it again. 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Very good. A 2, 1, 2. Can you see that? Yeah, you can see that. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 4 again. 1, 2, 3, 4. A 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Well, I don't have any more, but that determines that last pile. Okay, and then we'll simply stack these in the opposite order to which we were dealing them. Okay, that seems like a reasonable thing to do. So let's go ahead for the first time and find out what cards we randomly chose and what order did we actually put them in together. So let's just see what we did. Ooh, that's weird. Ace through King of Clubs. You've got to be kidding me. Ace through King of Hearts. How in the world did we do that? How did we do that? Okay, so that's what we're looking at today, actually. Oh, and then also I want to point out something here. You might think that, like the whole deck was set up or something, right? I mean, that was very orderly. Well, let's just see. That doesn't look like it's in any particular order. Do you see any ordering there? I certainly do not. Wow. So I really am surprised by what the two of us working together were able to accomplish there. Okay, so let's talk about, as I mentioned, something that I don't think has actually ever been shared before. And it's something that I've discovered recently while working with what are called B brackets. Now, if you've looked at some of my other videos that talk about B brackets, it's simply a way to describe what is happening with certain kind of mathematical card effects, okay? And I have a video, I think it's under the Simple Math Card Magic playlist, where I talk about B brackets and kind of what they mean and how to use them in a way that gives you insights as to kind of what's going on with various packets and various mixing procedures. Okay, so you may want to take a look at that. Now, what I'm hoping to do is actually kind of explain this well enough that I think you'll be able to follow it, perhaps without having to look at that little video on B brackets. But I still recommend that you look at it if you want to kind of go deeply into really what's going on here. Okay, so to my knowledge, once again, this has never been seen before, so I wasn't sure what to call it. Now, at the heart of this is a packet reversal, okay? And now it is true in the end, we got this perfect ordering, right, of the cards. And that could have been achieved with or without that final little dealing out that I did where I employed the die roll to help me, okay? So we could have finished with the same ending without that little additional mixing, or with it, of course. That's how we did it here just now. Okay, but the heart of the matter is something that we need to talk about and look at this B bracket notation to make sense of what's going on. Okay, so here's kind of the setup. Suppose you have a packet of P cards, and maybe just to clarify, the packet size that I was focused on was 26, right? Because the top 26 cards are these special cards here. Okay, so these are the cards I'm hoping to either reverse their order or preserve their order, okay? So 26 will be our packet size, relating this to what we just did. Now, the square brackets, what this means is it denotes a pile of cards. So here we know I had 26 cards of a special kind that we just showed you at the top of the deck. And then I have a comma and then ellipses. The ellipses just represents the rest of the deck or the rest of the cards, okay? So what I had you do is I had you randomly cut fewer than 26 cards, so we can represent that by the variable x, and we set that aside as a separate pile. Okay, so that was kind of the first little step there. Okay, now what happened after that? Well, once we had you cut the x number of cards, we can now denote it as a second pile, or a separate pile, I should say. What's a second as well? Okay, so we have square brackets with x in the inside. This is denoting that pile of cut-off cards, the ones you cut off, actually. Now, that will leave us with x fewer cards in the other pile, right? Because it's just been decreased by that quantity of cards, okay? Now, what we're doing here, and it's a common thing with this bracket, B bracket notation, is you kind of have to look ahead as to what a clever rewriting of this exact expression would be helpful in giving us a picture of really what's going on. And so what we've done here is, if you notice, we have P minus X. Well, that's the same. Now, there's the rest of the deck over here, okay? So certainly, In terms of additional cards, there'll be at least as many as you just cut below this remaining portion of the P cards that I had in that special order from the start. Okay, so this is a meaningful thing to write right here. And then there will be additional cards in the deck. There will be some left over. Okay, and you can kind of see why it was important for me to have you not cut more than 26 cards. But notice what happens with the algebra here. So if you actually add the number of cards that are being kind of denoted here, we would have a P minus X right there, parentheses if we like, plus X. Well, that isn't that not just equal to P, right? Because the subtract X, add X, that operation, those operations cancel out each other. So this really is another way of just writing the quantity P, okay? Well, why would we want to do that? Well, the quantity here of cards that I wanted to kind of preserve or protect was this number P. So in our case, it was 26 in the example we just did. And that is the number of cards that I need to deal into a separate pile on the table, okay, and which is what I did. So when I was supposedly concentrating and dealing cards out into some unknown number of cards, and I was going to just kind of stop when I felt like I should stop dealing, I actually just dealt out, in fits and starts, 26 cards. So in the end, I just dealt out 26 cards, okay? Now, what is that going to do? Think about it. So now these cards are at the top of that pile, and then it's followed by this quantity, and then followed by a bunch of unknown cards down there. Well, if we deal off, quote, P cards, we will only get to this part right here, and then we'll stop. So when we're dealing out P cards, the ones that will actually be dealt out into this pile are the ones that are being denoted right here, okay? Well, recall that, or realize that when you deal out cards, you reverse their order, okay? So the cards here are going to be reversed in order as we deal them to the table. Okay, so that's what this bar is here for. The bar is reminding us that these cards have all been reversed from their original order here. So as we deal these out, they're in the reverse order now, okay? But equally important, notice what happens here. These cards here, which were at the bottom of the list of P cards, will now be at the top, and the ones that were at the top of that pile will now be at the bottom of this pile of P cards, right? So they switch places, and that simply happens because we are reverse counting, right? So this right here ends up kind of on top, and then what was on top ends up on the bottom. Okay, and then I noted that all of the cards involved have been reversed within these individual groups of cards, okay? And then what I did, if you remember, I picked up your little pile of cut cards, and I said, I wonder how many cards are here. Now, there's two purposes for doing that. One is to find out how many there are, quantity. But as I reverse count those, it reverses the order of those cards. Okay, so that's an important thing to realize as well. Okay, and we're almost done here. And then what I did was, if you remember, I removed, whatever the number of cards was in your packet of cut cards, I removed that same quantity of cards from the other pile, from the main pile, the pile that I just dealt of P cards to the table. So I kind of threw those away. Okay, so this is where we were, just to kind of remind you, this is where we were back here, so there's no change here, right? So this is where, in step two, the second pile looked like that. After step three, this pile changed, but this one stayed the same. I just want to point that out. And now what's happening is, and I'm going off the going off the screen there, sorry about that. So this little expression here is exactly this one here. Okay, so there's no funny business here. I've just copied it down again. And so what I'm saying here is that if we remove the top X number of cards from here, well, we do have X number of cards, namely right here, right? The quantity of cards here is the same as the quantity of cards that were, you know, that cut, right, from there by the spectator. Well, if we throw these away, the only ones we're left with are the ones over here, okay? So we truly will now be right here. Okay, so if you think about it, what we have then is we have a pile, this pile right here that came from, you know, removing that X number of cards. But remember, we still have the cut cards, right, that you cut. And because I reverse counted them, they're going to be reversed, right, in order. So we have these two piles here. Well, if you remember, what I did was I took this pile and I very nonchalantly dropped it on top of that one. So you set this pile on top of the cut cards. And what will happen now, if you look at, you know, the quantity of cards we have, so we have P minus X plus X. So that is the number of cards that we will have in that combined packet. Okay, and of course, you could probably see the algebra here, right? So we're kind of looking at this situation. We have P minus X plus X. Well, the X's cancel out here. We just get P. So that pile of cards, where, you know, came from stacking the two piles that we were just working with, will actually have 26 cards in it, in our case, or P number of cards. But the important thing, look at what has happened to their order. They have been reversed, okay? Their order has been reversed from what it was at the very, very beginning, right? So we started with P cards, and their order has been reversed. And I guess I should also point it out. See, we started with, you know, the whole deck. So we started with not only 26 cards, but plus some other cards. Well, because of discarding cards and so forth, we genuinely have just 26 cards now at the end. And they are the cards that came from the top portion of the deck, okay? But they are in reverse order, okay? So that's an important thing to point out. So one way to have arrived at that packet structure at the end, Ace of Clubs through the King of Clubs, Ace of Hearts through the King of Hearts, would be to have those 26 cards at the top, but in reverse order to what I just stated. And if we have that in reverse order, and then we reverse it, by this process we'll end up reversing those, then they'll be back in their natural order, ace through king and ace through king, okay? So that would be one way to arrive at that same conclusion here, you know, when I spread these out and I go, how in the world did we do that, right? You just start with these reversed at the top. That would work. But what I did was I added another phase, which I think strengthens the whole thing. I actually began with the deck having these exactly in that order on top of these other just randomly mixed spades and diamonds. Okay, so these were like below those, okay? And so when we go through this process, this P bar is actually going to be these in reverse order. And then I added that other element of mixing. It's a special shuffle and one that has no name as well. So in my Hidden Structures online course, I give it a name. It's called The First Shall Be Last and The Last Shall Be First. And it ends up being a very slick way of reversing the order of a packet of cards. Okay, so how that works is you, and so you'll recognize this now. If you remember, I was dealing out until the die roll told me to stop, or if you were across the table from me, you would say, stop, stop, and I would just deal out until you tell me to stop and go on to the next pile. Okay, just like this. And we're going to run out of space, so I'll stop there. Okay, and so what we did from here, if you remember, is we stacked them in the opposite order to which they were dealt. And so that's why this shuffle has been christened The First Shall Be Last and The Last Shall Be First, because the first cards dealt are the ones over here. In fact, the very first card dealt is way down there, and the last card dealt is this one. So The First Shall Be Last and The Last Cards Shall Be First. These are the ones that we pick up first. Okay, so you just pick them up in opposite order. That's all that means. And so it's a very, I think, very clever way of reversing a packet. That's all it does. It reverses its order. Okay? So at the end of the procedure that we just showed you here, if I started with these cards in their natural order of ace through king, this little procedure, these five steps, would have reversed that, and then this first shall be last, last shall be first, little shuffle would have reversed that. So it would have brought it back to the original order in which they were placed on top of the deck at the very beginning. Okay, wow, that's a lot to kind of process there. Okay, so this is a very interesting, fun, and I think a powerful way to reverse a packet of cards. But we're doing it in such a way that because of spectator freedom to cut as many cards as they like, and then if we follow up this five-step procedure with a first shall be last, last shall be first, they're making lots of choices along the way. And so not only are they playing a role in which cards are being selected, but also the order of the cards. But yet, taking all of that together, we have lost no control. We can guarantee that a certain number of cards, in our case here it was 26 cards, are actually preserved in their original order at the start of the routine. Okay, so this is a wonderful way to reverse the order of a packet of cards, but give the illusion that really no one can know what cards are there, and more specifically, what order those cards are in. Even if you had some ideas to like what cards might be there, it would appear that you would have no way of knowing the order of the cards, when in fact you do if you understand the mathematics of what's going on here. Okay, so I thought I would just put this out into the world of mathematical card effects and have people kind of play with this. And it's a powerful little technique, I think. So I appreciate you watching, and I hope that some people explore this and add to it and modify it, and come up with interesting routines that employ this little technique, this packet reversal technique, because once again, to my knowledge, no one is aware of this. No one is talked about this. So thank you for watching.